Hello everyone. In today's video, I want to clear out some common misconceptions about some of the most important factors that are needed for building muscle mass. Most people think that they need to increase their protein intake to build more muscle, but in reality, there are a lot more things involved. Protein is a vital micronutrient that plays a role in several physiological functions such as tissue growth and repair, hormone and enzyme production, and immune system function. And how much we need really depends on the gender, body weight, activity level, and other factors. Studies indicate that during periods of infection or muscle damage, the body's protein requirement increases to about 1.5 to 2 grams per kilogram of body weight per day, compared to the minimum intake of 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight per day for sedentary individuals. The key word here is kilogram of body weight, not your total weight. You can get accurate assessment of how much of your weight is actually muscle mass versus fat by doing something called bioelectrical impedance analysis, which is a method used to estimate body composition. For individuals interested in building muscle mass, research suggests that protein intake within a range of 1.6 to 2.4 grams per kilogram per body weight per day may be optimal for muscle growth. Now moving on to growth hormone. Growth hormone plays a crucial role in stimulating protein synthesis. It promotes the uptake of amino acids by muscle cells, which are then used to build and repair muscle tissue. Now growth hormone also helps to mobilize fat stores and increase energy availability, which can support muscle growth during times of calorie restriction. High blood glucose level can inhibit growth hormone secretion by stimulating insulin release, which in turn suppresses growth hormone secretion. However, here we have to distinguish between temporary elevation of blood glucose, which is a normal response after meal, versus insulin resistance, where blood glucose remains elevated for extended period of time. In healthy individuals, without insulin resistance, the suppression of growth hormone via release of insulin after high carbohydrate meal is usually short-lived and does not have significant impact of overall growth hormone levels. In fact, studies have shown that growth hormone release is primarily stimulated by sleep and exercise. In particular, resistance exercise has the most potent effect on increasing the growth hormone release. Stress can also affect growth hormone release. Short-term stress, such as exercise-induced stress, increases growth hormone release, while chronic stress can actually suppress growth hormone release and contribute to growth hormone deficiency. Now, when it comes to insulin resistance, there is evidence to suggest that insulin resistance can interfere with normal regulation of growth hormone secretion. Insulin resistance is a condition where the body's cells become less responsive to insulin, which leads to buildup of glucose and insulin in the blood. Insulin plays a critical role in protein synthesis by helping transport amino acids into the muscle cells for growth and repair. However, when the body becomes insulin resistant and there are high levels of circulating insulin along with blood glucose, this process is impaired because the high levels of insulin impair the function of the growth hormone. In this scenario, insulin can blunt the release of growth hormone despite other stimulus which normally would promote release of growth hormone, such as exercise and sleep. Additionally, insulin resistance has been shown to impair the production of insulin like growth factor 1, which is a hormone that is closely related to growth hormone and also plays a critical role in muscle growth and repair. Now, one common misconception is that consuming too much protein can lead to insulin resistance. However, that's actually not the case. Primary reason for insulin resistance is not consuming too much protein, but actually excess of carbohydrate and saturated fats, which can increase inflammation and interfere with insulin signaling. Now, let's talk about a misconception that intermittent fasting is better than eating 3 meals a day for building muscle mass. Several studies have investigated the relationship between meal frequency and intermittent fasting and muscle growth. While some studies have suggested that intermittent fasting may increase growth hormone levels, it's not clear whether this translates to significant improvement in muscle growth. One study published in the Journal of Internal Society of Sports Nutrition found that meals frequency did not have significant effect on muscle mass or strength training gains in resistance trained individuals. Another study published in the Journal of the International Society of Sports Nutrition found that intermittent fasting did not lead to greater muscle growth or fat loss than traditional diet methods. So while fasting may increase growth hormone levels, the evidence does not suggest that it is superior to eating regular meals for muscle growth. Resistance training remains the most effective ways to stimulate muscle growth, and balanced diet with adequate protein intake is essential for optimal results. Now, is it important if you consume protein before or after workout? The reality is that consuming protein both before or after workout has been shown to enhance muscle protein synthesis, which is the process by which muscle fibers repair and grow in response to exercise. This is because exercise stimulates muscle protein synthesis, and consuming protein provides necessary building blocks, the amino acids, to support this process. However, it's important to note that the overall daily intake of protein is still more critical for muscle growth and repair than timing alone. In other words, while consuming protein before or after workout can be beneficial, it is not a substitute for meeting your daily protein need. It is recommended that individuals aiming to build muscle mass consume a high protein diet throughout the day, with regular protein intake at meal and snacks to provide the necessary amino acids for muscle protein synthesis and muscle growth. So let's talk about which type of exercise is the best for muscle protein synthesis. While intense exercise can stimulate muscle protein synthesis to some extent, resistance training has been shown to be far more superior in activating muscle growth. This is because resistance training causes muscle fibers to undergo microscopic damage, known as muscle fiber damage or muscle damage. The muscle damage stimulates muscle protein synthesis as the body works out to repair and rebuild the damaged muscles. Resistance training involves working against a force or weight, such as lifting weights or using resistance bands. This type of training puts stress on the muscle, causing it to adapt and become stronger. As the muscle adapts and becomes stronger, it also grows in size, which is a process known as muscle hypertrophy. Research studies have shown that resistance training is more effective stimulus to muscle protein synthesis and growth compared to endurance training. Study published in the Journal of Applied Physiology found that resistance training resulted in a greater increase in muscle protein synthesis compared to endurance training. Now let's talk about a few more things that have circulated recently in the media as important factors for muscle synthesis, and let's see what the current research has to say. Let's start with the relationship between zinc and testosterone. Testosterone is an important hormone for muscle synthesis, and it helps to increase muscle mass and strength. Zinc is a mineral that is important for testosterone production, and a deficiency in zinc can lead to lower testosterone levels. Now, some studies have suggested that zinc supplementation may increase testosterone levels, but the results have been mixed and the effect may depend on individual baseline zinc levels. Again, we are looking at the baseline level of the zinc. In a healthy man with normal zinc levels, increasing zinc intake may not have significant impact on testosterone levels. However, for individuals with low zinc levels, zinc supplementation may be beneficial to improving testosterone levels and muscle growth. It is also important to know that excessive zinc intake can be harmful and may lead to toxicity, so it is important to consume zinc in moderation and under the guidance of a healthcare professional. What about the role of soy protein, beer, and phytoestrogen and their impact on muscle protein synthesis? Estrogen is a hormone that is present in both men and women, but in different amounts. Testosterone, on the other hand, is primarily a male hormone that plays a critical role in muscle synthesis, bone density, and sex drive. Estrogen can have negative impact on testosterone level, with high level of estrogen inhibiting the production of testosterone. Soy protein isolate is a common source of plant-based protein, and it contains compounds called phytoestrogens that can mimic the effect of estrogen in the body. Some research has suggested that consuming soy protein isolates may lead to increased estrogen levels in men, which could potentially impact estrogen levels. However, other studies have found no significant effect of soy protein isolates on testosterone levels. Beer is also sometimes linked to increased estrogen levels in men due to the presence of hops, which contains phytoestrogens. However, the evidence regarding the impact of beer on estrogen level in men is mixed. Some studies have found no significant effect of beer consumption on estrogen levels in men, while others have found a small increase. Overall, while it is accurate to say that estrogen can inhibit testosterone, the impact of soy protein isolate or beer on estrogen level in men is not well established. Now how about amino acid called leucine? Leucine is an essential amino acid that plays a critical role in muscle protein synthesis. Studies have shown that lecithin supplementation can increase muscle protein synthesis and improve muscle mass and strength. Some plant-based sources such as soy protein isolate have been found to contain higher levels of leucine than some animal-based sources such as milk protein. However, it's worth noting that animal-based sources of protein generally contain a more complete amino acid profile, including all the amino acids needed for muscle protein synthesis. Therefore, while plant-based sources like soy protein isolate can be a valuable addition to muscle-building diet, it's important also to include a variety of animal-based protein. Bodybuilders and athletes can obtain leucines from dietary sources, and supplementation is usually not necessary for most individuals. However, some studies have suggested that leucine supplementation may be beneficial for individuals who are unable to consume adequate amount of dietary protein or for those who are undergoing intense training requirements. For example, a study published in the Journal of Internal Society of Sports Nutrition found that leucine supplementation improved muscle protein synthesis and muscle mass in elderly individuals who were unable to consume sufficient amount of dietary protein. So what about chronic stress? Now stress is known to have both physical and psychological effect on body, including on muscle mass. Chronic stress has been shown to increase the level of hormone cortisol, which can promote muscle breakdown and reduce muscle protein synthesis. This can lead to muscle wasting and decrease in muscle mass over time. However, the impact of chronic stress on muscle mass in healthy individuals is not entirely clear. Some studies have suggested that negative effect of stress on muscle mass may be offset by other factors such as exercise and adequate nutrition. Lastly, while hydrochloric acid supplements can enhance amino acid supplementation, it is not clear how much of an impact this has on muscle growth in healthy individuals. There have also been claims that natural protein sources with fat are better for muscle growth than lean protein sources, but this has not been supported by any rigorous studies. However, there is nothing wrong with adding good fat to your lean protein meals. It is as simple as adding a tablespoon of olive oil to your salad with balsamic vinaigrette. You do not have to load yourself with saturated fats from animal sources. So there you have it, the most important factors in building muscle beyond dietary protein. I hope this information is helpful to achieve your fitness goals.